Unfortunately, it seems like
perhaps overall the people's background went down coming in. I feel like we added an extra 20% to the course of the least prepared people. So there's lots of problems with stuff that we're used to thinking that people in high school they just don't seem to be able to do in 10-13, 10-14 anymore.
In New South Wales, we aren't taught any vector.
Yeah, no, the vector stuff, yeah. I mean, but 10-13 starts.
I know.
Not assuming that, but like, yeah. Integration by parts, we sort of hope that people can do.
Oh, right, yeah.
So it's sort of basic things like that, yeah, causing problems now. Okay, so let's work out where on earth we're up to. So we've started talking about product measures. And I think last time I very, very briefly sketched how you might construct product measures the fancy way, using random integrals, and this idea in the Stone-Weierstrass theorem that products of continuous functions are dense in the continuous functions, at least with some compactness assumptions and so on, but we decided not to go through all the details of that, and instead do product measures sort of the conventional way. So I think that I got as far as saying that if you've got two sigma algebras on two different spaces, then this was the sigma algebra generated by what you might call measurable rectangles, so a product of a set in here and a product of and a set in here. Okay. So so it's maybe not particularly surprising the way that you construct product measures. So to construct product measure on that product sigma algebra, we're just going to use the machinery from the Cara-Teodoro extension theorem. So we'll define a pre-measure, which remember was one of these gadgets. So it was just defined on some algebra of sets, and we use that machinery to boost it all the way up to something defined on the sigma algebra generated by that algebra, which is going to be exactly that. So of course it's going to be a pre-measure on B0, the Boolean algebra generated by measurable rectangles. Okay, now the nice fact is that when we say the Boolean algebra generated by measurable rectangles, it's actually very easy to describe what this whole Boolean algebra looks like. Remember, in general, when you have a Boolean algebra generated by something, you have to take finite unions of things, and then complements, and then finite unions, and it might go on many, many, many steps. But in fact, B0 is just finite unions of rectangles. The way to think about this is just that, well, if you've got a measurable rectangle, it is a finite union, oh sorry, its complement is the finite union of measurable rectangles. If you've got that rectangle there, its complement is the union of those 8 bits out there, and those are all by definition measurable because these guys individually were closed under complements. And moreover, if you've got two rectangles and you intersect them, the intersection is automatically just a rectangle again. Okay, so I mean, you do have to think about if you wanted to really obsessively, carefully check that, you'd have to think about the different ways in which things can overlap. But fine. Okay, so we get that, and we just need to define a pre-measure on that. So it's pretty obvious that what we should do is and in fact, even let's do one step even better, or even finite disjoint unions. Of those rectangles. And here we're finally using the fact that if you write this, if you write the union of two rectangles, you can always write that as a that wasn't quite the right picture, was it? As a disjoint union of rectangles as well. Okay. And so then we just define mu naught of some disjoint union of EIs and FIs. You guys know this symbol, like a big square cup instead of a square cup, to just be the sum of what we call mu1 EI times mu2 of FI. But we need to check a few things to make sure that that makes sense. So the first thing is check this is well defined. And there's something to do here. I mean, you might have some disjoint union of rectangles is equal to the disjoint union of another collection of disjoint rectangles. But it's pretty easy to check that if you've got one way to write a set as a disjoint union of rectangles in two different ways, there's just a sort of common refinement of doing both, and that lets you prove that fact. Straight from the definition, mu naught, of course, is finitely additive. And that's all we needed to check. To see that we were talking about a pre-measure. Okay. So, it's not what we need to check. We now need to check the main property, which is just that if you have, let's see, how do I want to write this? If S is some union of SIs, with S and all the SIs all in V0, we need to make sure that mu naught of S is actually, let me just use the disjoint symbol there to avoid writing the word disjoint, really is the sum of the mu naughts of the SIs. So let's see. In some sense, what we, the sort of discussion we were doing just here, basically all already covers this. Using finite additivity, if S itself is a union, not just a single rectangle, rectangles. Okay, there's no requirement, obviously, that any of these things are rectangles, but intersect everything with each Ri. And then if you know this holds when S is a rectangle, you easily see that it holds when S is a union of rectangles. So that shows it suffices to assume. Single rectangle, and then similarly, if one of the SIs is a union of several rectangles, of course you can just replace this set of all the SIs with some bigger set, writing out all of the things that made up that particular SI as separate elements of the set. So we may also assume each SI. And so our job is just to prove this. If we have E cross F equals a disjoint union of EIs cross FIs, then we need to show mu1 of E, mu2 of F is the sum of mu1 of EI, mu2 times F. And that we have, this is not something that we've actually done yet. Let's squeeze in here how one does it. It's pretty straightforward. you look at the characteristic function of E times the characteristic function of F, evaluated at X and at Y, and that is a sum just by this formula of the characteristic function of EI at X times the characteristic function of FI at Y. That's exactly what it means for a set to be a distributed union of other sets, really. And now, what can we do? And of course, this is a, maybe I should have been, we should be really clear here. This is just it's a countable sum. This is a countable sum, we're having to deal with it. Okay. So you might actually worry at this point about the sense in which I mean that this is equal to the limit of that, okay? If this is actually an infinite sum here, I'm just saying this fact point-wise. At each x and y, that's true, but we don't need to worry about, we're not writing an expression for the actual things. Okay, so you just integrate over x1 and use the MCT to move that sum out. And so when you integrate over x1, this just becomes, I think in the notes I did it the other order, but it really doesn't matter which way you do it. So this just becomes...
What's x1?
X1 is the... Yeah, sorry, I never was it on these boards. X1 and x2 are the spaces that came at the beginning equipped with sigma algebras and measures, and we're trying to produce a measure on x1 cross x2. This was a sigma algebra on x1 cross s2. And finally, we're in the process of building the measure by the pre-measure. Okay, so we integrate this over x1. This is just some constant term, and we're just integrating that. So by definition, that's just mu1 of e. And now I'm allowed to move the integral in through the sum. So I get the integral, so the sum, and then the integral hits that, and we get the measure of ei times chi fi at y. And so then, of course, you integrate over x2. Again, use the monotone convergence theorem, and we get exactly what we want. You can see then that this expression turns into exactly that one. So I won't write it out. Okay, and that's all there is to do it. To do. So that gave a pre-measure, and so. The extension theorem gives a measure on the sigma algebra generated by this Boolean algebra, but that was exactly how we defined M1 cross M2. Not so scary. Now, there is, however, a very subtle point in all of this, which is that although this procedure did produce a measure on M1 cross M2, you have to be pretty careful, because it turns out that in general, there is not a unique measure on x1 cross, I should have said it, on x1 cross x2. There's not a unique measure on x1 cross x2 with the property that the measure of a measurable rectangle is the product of the measures. But that makes us very sad. We'd really like to have a unique measure on the product. But for uniqueness, we need sigma finiteness. Okay? And one of the problems on assignment 3 is exactly about a counterexample, showing that there are
non-unique ways to extend that pre-measure that we talked about to a measure on x1 cross x2 if you don't have sigma finals. So I think it's probably best if we just talk a little bit about how you do that sort of uniqueness. So this is something that maybe I should have said when talking about the extension theorem in the first place, but I didn't. So let's try this. So mu naught is going to be some pre-measure on a Boolean algebra B naught, and let M be the extension from the Carotid-Duras extension theorem. Which maybe I should write the formula for. So we call what was this? How did we get a measure out of a pre-measure? It had an infimum. So we take some sets EI that whose union is bigger than E, and the EIs are in the Boolean algebra, and then we look at the sum of those pre-measures of the EIs. Okay, so we're taking our slightly crazy set and covering it up with some very nice sets in the Boolean algebra. And then letting them shrink down, and not worrying about the overlap. I mean, this obviously includes the overlaps, but as they shrink, you hope those go away. Okay. So now we've got to finish the statement of the lemma. So suppose, let's even write this to give it a name. Let's say that the sigma algebra that this mu was defined on was M. And suppose then we've got some other sigma algebra, M prime, and some measure on that, which also extends mu naught. So in particular, I'm saying that like this is a sigma algebra containing the Boolean algebra that we started with. Okay. If but not otherwise. So if your space is sigma finite with respect to the pre-measure, so you can write X as a countable union of sets, which are all in the Boolean algebra and all have finite measure, then mu, the one we got from the extension theorem, and mu prime, this crazy other one, agree where they're both defined. That is on the intersection of those guys. But of course, notice that intersection certainly contains the sigma algebra generated by the Boolean algebra, because those are both sigma algebras containing the whole Boolean algebra. Okay, so I was a little indecisive about whether to prove this or not. I think previous iterations of the course always just leave it as an exercise. But it's somehow like it's such a nice example of like all of the basic tricks of how you prove inequalities in analysis, in sort of this sort of analysis, that I feel like I sort of want to do it anyway. I don't know. I'm happy to take instruction from you guys about whether this sounds boring or whether we should do it. I saw one nod and a few smiles, so I'll take that as freedom to. Okay, so say we've got some set that's measurable according to both of the measures. We need to prove that the measure of E equals measure prime of E. Okay, so if you're following your nose and doing analysis and you need to prove two quantities are equal, what do you do? Yeah, exactly. So one is less than the other and the other is less than the one. Great. So you probably stop and try and think a little bit about which one's easier. And try and do that one first, because it might give you some ideas about how to do the harder one. Is it totally obvious which one's going to be easier? Maybe it is. The point is that one of these guys we know almost nothing about, but one of them is an infimum. Okay. So there's sort of an easy strategy to prove that something is less than an infimum. You just show that something is less than every single thing in the infimum. So there's sort of an obvious approach to proving something is less than an infimum. So let's hope that that's the easy one. So that's the second one, actually. Okay. Okay. So obviously, we try to prove that mu prime of E is less than or equal to sum of mu norm of EIs, where E is sitting inside that union of the EIs, and the EIs are in the Boolean algebra, so it makes sense to take mu norm. Okay, so, how could we possibly do this? Well, it's not hard at all, and the point is that you've got an inclusion, you're trying to show this is small, but you've got an inclusion of sets here. So obviously you just use the fact that measures are increasing to write it like that. Okay? Then you just use, what is it, sort of countable subadditivity for, this is not a disjoint union at all, it's one of these pictures, so we just replace this with that's less than the sum of the mu primes of the EIs. Okay, but by hypothesis, mu prime really was an extension of the original mu naught. So when you plug in a set that's in the Boolean algebra, that's just what mu naught would have done to EI. And we're done. Okay? So that was really, as long as we remembered, okay. So we just followed our noses there. Okay. Now we've got something a little bit harder. But again, really following our noses will work. So we want to show this crazy infimum now is less than or equal to mu prime. Okay. So at that point, you should stop and think a little bit about what you're meant to do when you see an infimum. And your job is to show that the infimum is less than something. How do you show that an infimum is less than some fixed quantity? Looks like you have an A.
I don't know. You try to show that your quantity is in the something in your things. What's the name for?
Yeah, you could. So let's see. So I think that we could try and show that there is some point in here that is less than that number. Yeah, that we can find some point here, so this value is actually less than. But we sort of expect that maybe that's dangerous, because if we go back and think about it, we're actually trying to show these things are equal. So the real thing that's going on is this is actually equal to the infimum. So perhaps it's too ambitious to actually find a point in here that's strictly smaller, because this might be an infimum that doesn't have a minimum, but this theorem is still meant to be true. So we can't quite do that. But yeah, it's the first thing you should try when to show that an infimum is less than something. So let's just have a little aside. So to show L, so I'm thinking of L is like that guy, is bigger than infimum over some set of of some quantity. Good strategy is to try to prove that L is bigger than the infimum over X of Kx minus epsilon for every epsilon. So we know that if we can do this for every epsilon, that does imply that. Because, and the reason why giving yourself an epsilon of room is a good idea, as then it's enough to show that L is bigger than or equal to K of X naught minus epsilon for some X naught. But we neatly got around that problem that we had with Adele's initial suggestion, because even if there was an equality here, we would expect to still be able to do that. Okay? Even if actually this L is equal to the infimum, because we've gone down by epsilon, we hope that we can do that. And even better, if you think that's what you're meant to be doing, you even have an obvious place to start. Like, so the job now becomes to pick some X naught that makes that work. But sort of by definition of this being an infimum, there's a good place to pick. So a good candidate for X naught, well, some X naught, so K of X naught is less than or equal to the infimum of K of X plus a little bit. I mean, just pick some X naught that's really close to the actual infimum, and then now hope that you can do things. Okay, so here's a slightly subtle point. Why is this strategy, where on earth is sigma finiteness going to come into this problem? And you can finally see what's going on here. The thing you've got to be really careful about is that giving yourself an epsilon of room only makes progress if that thing you're giving yourself a bit of room from is actually finite. Okay? If that infimum were infinity, when we subtract off epsilon, it's still infinity and we kind of haven't got anywhere. So this sort of argument can't possibly work unless that infimum is finite. Of course, in our problem, what is that infimum? That infimum is just mu of E. Okay? But we've got some assumptions sitting around in our theorem that we're allowed to assume our space is a countable union of things with finite measures. So maybe we shouldn't worry about that later and come back and deal with it. Let's just add an assumption that makes this work. So let's assume, for now, that mu of E really is finite. So then we've got a chance of using this argument, and so let's see how it goes. Okay, so what does this sentence about picking some x naught actually mean with the L's and K's that we actually have here? What we're meant to do is pick some collection of EIs in the Boolean algebra with E sitting inside their union. And the sum of the premeasures of those EIs being not much bigger than the actual measure, the Cavatier-Dury extinction measure of the set E. Okay. So let's hope that we can just follow our noses and go a bit further, and we get to the I think the one point in this argument where if you have the right habits, it's still not necessarily obvious what to do. So we're meant to start with mu prime of E. Okay, we're meant to show that's bigger than something. And we're kind of stuck here, Because at the moment we just have no tools for showing that mu prime is bigger than anything. Like, I just can't think of anything to get started with here. E here is a subset of other things, you can't use in the increasingness of the measure. The inequality we've got here is about mu, not about mu prime. It's a bit sad. So what do we do? Well, the trick is the following. And this is, I think, a trick, but maybe it's a little bit motivated by the fact that we can go back and remember that we've done one, okay? So at this point, we do know that for arbitrary sets E, probably not the set we're thinking about at the moment, but for some other set, we know that mu prime is less than mu, okay? So what we can do is try and use that inequality to get a greater than here. So if we're going to use that inequality, it's going to have to be applied to something that appears with a negative sign here. So you'll see the trick in just a moment. All I'm going to do is write this as mu prime of the union of the EIs minus mu prime of the union of the EIs take away E. Okay, so it's like when we covered it over like that, we're saying that you can just take the measure of the whole thing and then subtract off all of this, that extra region, all that extra excess region. Okay, and that's a sneaky trick, because it now lets us go back and use part one on this term, because knowing that mu prime is smaller than something lets us say that negative mu prime is bigger than something, and now we're off and running. So, what do we do? Am I actually going to wait a moment before I do that? No. So we say that that's bigger than mu prime of the union of the EIs minus mu of am I just not seeing how to do some step? I now want to use this line. I guess I could. Now that I've switched from mu to mu prime, I'm going to use that trick in reverse and say that's the measure of the union of the EIs plus mu of E, which is, now lets me access that inequality. So that's bigger than mu prime, the union of the EIs. Minus mu, the union of the EIs, and how does this go? Plus the sum of the mu naughts of the EIs, minus epsilon. And we're still pretty good, because we can, at this point, throw away this part, because this is definitely bigger than that, by definition. This here was the infimum. Is that quantity smaller than that? I mean, this quantity is certainly less than the sum of the mu's of the EIs, and the mu's of the EIs and the mu naughts of the EIs are just the same. So then we can get down all the way down to that. Are we happy yet? What's the problem? What are we aiming for on the right-hand side here? We're still aiming on the right-hand side for mu of E. This looks kind of hopeless so far. It's still got a mu prime in it. So what can we do? What's that?
Are the EIs just in the B law, which is where they agree?
Yeah, so the EIs are in B naught, so you might think, oh yeah, we can change mu prime to mu, but the problem is it's a countable union here, so the union is not in B naught anymore. But somehow, we've got to use the fact that, I mean, all that we've got going for us, if we want to turn that mu prime back into a mu, is that they agree on B naught. So somehow we've got to replace that infinite union with a finite union. We've got to change this to a finite union somehow. So how could we do that? Well, why don't we just throw out infinitely many of the terms and see what happens? So that's bigger than mu prime of the union from I equals 0 up to big N of the EIs minus epsilon. And that's just true for any N. Okay? Just because the infinite union was just bigger than the finite union. Okay? Okay, so that's a little scary, but now we can do what we want to do. We can rewrite that as mu of this union, because now we're in there. And what we want is that this is greater than or equal to, we're looking for that. Maybe, I'll give you a little hint here. I'll put a little tilde over that to indicate, it doesn't really matter if we hit the exact epsilon we were going for in the first place. We're always allowed to go back and modify our argument and turn into epsilon over two arguments and so on. So how can we get from here to here?
Can you take the n larger and larger?
Exactly, yeah.
Approximate.
Yeah, so that is bigger than mu of the infinite union. But we have to subtract another epsilon to do that for sufficiently large n. Okay, we could go back and edit a bunch of our epsilons that we did here to make them epsilon over twos, and then if we wanted to. But that I think is the end of the argument. What have we left out? What have we left out? Have we really finished proving this lemma? We threw in this assumption we need to deal with the. We need to actually use sigma finiteness to get us out of that. So, let's be a little careful here. You can only actually do that step there if this quantity is finite. Are we confident of that? Like, you can't. Finitely many terms will never get within epsilon of infinity. But what should we have done? I think we're okay, because we said that mu of E was finite. So mu of E plus epsilon is still finite. So the sum of the mu naughts of all the EIs is finite. And that quantity is still less than this guy. So we are safe there. But if a computer was checking our proofs, it would have complained at that point that we didn't discharge that auxiliary goal. Okay, so if this is infinite, what on earth do you do? Well, you just do what you always do. You write E as a union of, I kind of want to use EI, but that's very confusing, so let's call them FJs with each. I changed between last night writing notes and today I changed notation. I just meant mu, sorry. The reason I was writing mu star in these notes, which will get text shortly, is that in that Caratteodoro extension theorem, you often write that extended measure as mu upper star. But I changed my mind. Okay. So, but here the point is that you can just do this where each of these is has finite measure, and in fact, they're still in both sigma algebras, and in fact, you can do it as a disjoint union just by, if they weren't disjoint, just taking sort of different, like let the nth one be the nth one minus what we had before. And then, but then of course, we have mu v is the sum of the mu's of the fj's, but that's the sum of the mu primes of the fj's because we did that in the finite measure case, and that's mu prime of it. Okay, so as usual, the infinite case is actually really easy once you've done the finite case. But
is that the sigma finite?
So we're using sigma finiteness to do this. So here we're using the fact that you can write x as a disjoint union of xi's, and then when we say do this, we just mean let fj equal e intersect xj. And these ones here, in fact, here, because the assumption was really that x was sigma finite with respect to mu naught, so you can really do this with each xi in b0, and mu naught of xi finite, which is maybe even stronger than what I wrote here. Okay, so that's kind of neat. That's how you show that in the sigma finite world, extinctions are extinctions unique. Oh dear, okay. As usual, that took up lots of time. So, what did I want to do? So we've now actually got to prove one or two things about product measures, and the right thing to do is to prove the Fabini-Tonelli theorem, which hopefully you guys remember what it says, but we haven't really seen a proof in the general case. So the final version we're aiming for should say if you've got some measurable function on a product space, which is absolutely integrable, so it's the absolute value of the function is integrable, then you can either calculate the integral on the product space of the original function, or you can do the iterated integral one way, or you can do the iterated integral the other way. They're all the same. So let me give you one version of a sneaky proof. It might be too little time, we might have to come back to it. So a monotone class is a collection of subsets of X closed under two operations. Countable increasing union, i.e., if you've got a sort of tower of sets getting bigger and bigger and bigger that are all in the monotone class, then their union is in the monotone class as well, and also closed under countable decreasing intersection. And then the lemma. Monotone class lemma says if A is a Boolean algebra, actually the sigma algebra generated by A is equal to the monotone class generated by A. Okay? So what do I mean by the monotone class generated by A? I sort of just mean the usual thing. Take all monotone classes which contain A and intersect them. Okay? Certainly the power set is certainly a monotone class, so there's some monotone class containing any given collection of sets A, and so now we're just taking the coarsest monotone class containing the Boolean algebra. But there's this amazing fact that whether you generate the sigma algebra, where there you take arbitrary countable unions and also complements, or you generate the monotone class, where you only take countable increasing unions and countable decreasing intersections, then you actually get the same thing. And the proof of that is either amusing or tedious, depending on your point of view. You obviously do well. It really is a follow your nose kind of proof. You've got to show two sets are equal, so you show this is containing that, you show that's containing that, and you just follow the definitions over and over and over again, and you eventually get there. The proof will be in the notes. Let me not give it to you now, because I think we'll count it as tedious today. And let's give the 1 minute version of Tonelli's theorem. Okay, so we've got some function on a product space, and we're not doing the Fabini-Tonelli theorem, we're just doing Tonelli's theorem, so we're just assuming our function is positive valued for the first run through to make life easy. Okay, so then x goes to the integral over y of f of x, y is measurable. Similarly, the other way around, when you integrate over x, and the integral over x, y of f is equal to the integral over x of the integral over y of f is equal to the integral over y of the integral over x of f. And possibly these are just all infinite valued. We allow that, I suppose. Okay. So, does the proof really work this quickly? Okay, it does. Okay, I'll put up notes with a slow version of this. Okay. Oh, and x, y signify that. Maybe a good general point is that measure theory in the non-sigma finite world is stupid. You should avoid it. By the monotone convergence theorem and sigma finiteness, we can assume x, y a finite volume, finite measure. Okay. Chop f down by the characteristic functions of the finite measure things. Okay. By the MCT, it's enough to prove this for simple functions f, and by linearity, enough to do it for characteristic functions. Okay. So now let's see, with a set of S in this product sigma algebra, where the theorem holds. Okay, and our job is to show that actually C equals everything. Okay, by the MCT and the downwards MCT, which is a scary theorem because usually it doesn't hold when you've got pointwise convergence downwards, but it does hold when everything's finite measure. You're allowed to do downwards convergence of things, basically because you can go look at the proof of the MCT and see if it works there. By the fact that you can either converge downwards or converge upwards, C is a monotone class. Ha-ha. If you've got some collection of characteristic functions that are on sets that are growing and growing and growing, they are converging upwards to the characteristic function of the union. Okay? And so the MCT shows you that this is a monotone class. Similarly, you need to get intersections, you need the downwards MCT, because the characteristic functions of a decreasing intersection is descending pointwise downwards to the characteristic function of the intersection. Okay? And then easily, C contains the measurable rectangles. Okay, so if you just shove in here F being the characteristic function of a measurable set times a measurable set, it's obvious how to do all three of those integrals. And so, C contains the sigma algebra generated by them, by the measurable rectangles, i.e. everything that we care about. Okay? Sorry that was sort of fast. But this is Terry Tower's extraordinarily slick proof of the Tonelli theorem that I'd not seen anywhere else before, except in his book. It sort of, even though this is so slick, a lot of the work is being hidden in here that you would see in a conventional proof of Fortinelli theorem. Okay, great, we better stop because we're definitely over time. Enjoy the teaching break, and make sure you do assignment 2, and make sure you think about the essay during the teaching break.
Do we have any measure after the break as well?
So in some sense, I think that I want to get straight into the spectral theory stuff because we've spent quite a bit of time on this now. There is one big lurking thing that we haven't done, which is that if you take linear functionals, so we barely talked about LP spaces and LQ spaces in class, but you guys know what the definition for an abstract dimension space is. It's pretty easy. But the thing that we'd like to eventually prove is this, that linear function, where as usual, 1 over p plus 1 over q equals 1. And I guess the other fact we'd like to prove is that LP is complete with respect to the LP norm. And those are technically things that are sort of part of integration theory, but since we're going to study Banach spaces at the end of the course, and these are the main examples of Banach spaces, and understanding duals of Banach spaces is sort of the main point of understanding Banach space theory, we'll do all those examples as part of the Banach space stuff. That's a good question. The second week of the break, I will definitely be around in my office all day, every day. The first week, however, probably not so much. Probably actually Monday through Thursday, I'm probably barely going to be in my office. But Friday, I will be. I have some meetings with students in the morning, but if you wanted to talk Friday afternoon, maybe send me an email. But I will be near email, so if you want to ask questions about the assignment before it's due, we can we can do that by email a bit.